Welcome and thank you for your participation in this 10-minute video presentation on game day roles and responsibilities of a youth soccer coach. Thank you also just for being a coach. I hope that you will find this to be filled with practical ideas that you can apply right away to enjoy coaching more and, more importantly, to improve the experience that the kids have. This is an overview of topics we'll cover here. Unlike on practice days where you have to do a lot of planning, the action of the game will write its own script, but it is important for coaches to do some thoughtful planning in each of these areas, starting and ending with parent communications. It's hard to overstate how important parent communications have become. Ideally, you'd start with a preseason meeting in person to get everyone on the same page, or at least a well-crafted email that would state your expectations and a vision for the season, or in other words, what would a successful season look like. And having a plan for ongoing communication may be just as important. Just like we expect teachers in school to give us updates on our children's progress through report cards or conferences or a classroom update over email, this is a great idea for coaches. Maybe even just once or twice in a 6 or 8 or 10 week season, including what they should expect to see when they're sitting on the sidelines on game day. What have you worked on in training and how they can support that? So, for example, if you've tried to get the players to get more comfortable on the ball dribbling in traffic, if they know that, they can support that, they can cheer for that on game day, as opposed to potentially contradicting that effort by yelling things like kick it and boot it when the kid on the ball is under some pressure. They can also have richer conversations with their own children off the field before and after games to help support the learning targets that you've set for the kids. Having built a partnership with your own team parents, it's also important to connect with opposing coaches and officials prior to each game, just to get on the same page with them and make sure that you have the best chance to provide a positive experience for all players. Remember that officials are often young and inexperienced at this level, so the more you can do to support their efforts to learn and the long-term development process for becoming a good referee, just like for becoming a good player, the better chance we have of having a pool of better and more experienced officials at older ages. Coming up with a dynamic warm-up routine can be your responsibility, or perhaps the players have some input into that. This gets more important as players get older and more susceptible to joint and muscle injuries, but also helps improve performance as well. It's a good idea to have one or two objectives to remind your players of before they go out to play. This might be based on what you've worked on in training, or it might be what didn't go well in the last game and they've set a goal for this game to try to do better. And also you've created a starting lineup, so based on some rationale. So that might be who's done well in practice or previous games, or it might simply be a rotation so that everybody's going to get their turn to start. Regarding positions, this is a real challenge because we like to be organized and have things look neat and efficient, and the easiest way to do that with younger players is to identify spots on the field that are theirs, that belong to them. Ideally, they'd be learning positioning rather than just positions. Positioning meaning it's based on where the ball is, where their teammates are, where the opponents are, rather than positions in terms of a specific tract of real estate. Consider player movement in hockey or basketball, two other flow sports like soccer, where players move up and down the court or the rink together with roles identified within that team structure. It's a huge accomplishment for a youth coach if you can get young players to recognize how to both support the attack and how to help protect the goal, where their personal light bulb stays on throughout their time on the field instead of having to wait their turn to play when the ball comes into their area. The goalkeeper obviously is unique in that regard in that they tend to stay in one spot but should still be connected. So a movement would look more like that in regards to where the ball is and players moving in relation to that, positioning themselves in relation to the ball, rather than the line of defenders who aren't allowed to cross midfield, and they're simply waiting for the next wave of attack to come at them. Like your starting lineup, it's best to have a plan and a rationale for substitutions and playing time. In general, it's best to give players extended periods of time in the game, not short, all-out hockey shifts. And it's also wise to allow players to play every position over the course of a season, but consider not rotating them all around within a single game, as that can be really confusing for them, where they never get enough time to figure out a role before it changes on them. Inasmuch as the game will have its own script, we often have a tendency to try to direct the action and be the GPS voice in players' heads about where to go and what to do. We do really well to let the players make decisions, particularly the player on the ball, who has enough stimuli to sort out without trying to listen to advice coming from either the coaching side or the parent side. That's probably too late by the time it gets there anyway. But we do well to let them make choices and then ask questions or offer suggestions after moments have passed. Coaches can also frame competitions as great learning experiences for players, in addition to emphasizing striving to win, because that's part of competitive activities, but not because it satisfies our ego or our need for a result, more because it makes the game enjoyable for players if they're allowed to make their own choices, and it facilitates their learning and becoming a more creative, risk-taking, better player. Whether your local league plays quarters or halves, those natural breaks are built into the game so that players can get rest and water, but also a chance for you as the coach to circle back to your pregame objective or objectives. And instead of a monologue of your analysis, this would be a great opportunity to get a dialogue with the players and get them thinking. So it might start with a question like, "Hey, remember we were going to try to do X in the first half? How do you think we did?" And they get to be involved in that self-analysis and potentially goal-setting for the next period of play. These breaks are also the ideal time to make substitutions that don't interrupt the flow of the game during the half, and also to reinforce some of the positives so they feel good and encouraged going back out to play even if things haven't gone well to that point. After each game is a critical time for us to model good sportsmanship and to encourage players to display it. It's also a time to check on each player and make sure everyone's okay and communicate any potential injury issues to parents. Also, have a cool-down routine. So this could include some easy movement and stretching, or a team huddle and a kind of social unity time before everyone leaves. And a good time to recognize the positive. So even if you have some things that didn't go well that you want to address, it might be best to wait till the next practice opportunity to address those rather than hitting them with negatives after they can't do anything about it at that point. Post-game offers another opportunity to connect with parents and keep them in the loop. So it might be pointing out an individual child's progress in some area, or it might be updating all the parents on what the team's going to be working on next and perhaps how they can support that in their conversations with their kids, just like we'd expect a teacher to give us some progress reports throughout a school year. During a 6 to 8 week soccer season, it'd be ideal if a coach can give one or maybe a second progress report individually or on a team-wide basis to the parents to keep them informed. Soccer is a player's game, and it's largely under players' control, especially on game day. Instead of trying to wrest control back from them, we should be encouraging players to solve problems, to take risks, and to give full effort while learning from the game. A successful season should include their being able to say at the end of it, "I had a great time, and I learned a lot." That would help them want to come back. A wise coach, when asked at the end of a season how the season went, responded, "It's too soon to know. Ask me again in 5 or 10 years." On behalf of all the kids who play, thank you for coaching.